That was lively, wasn't it? Hope you guys all had a wonderful week. I did. I managed to get my computer back to work. As you can see, I am in my normal environment. I have a ton of SSDs right here that I have made backups to, as well as a huge 3 terabyte drive for all my video projects. Those are backed up as well, and I have other drives underneath here on the floor that are not connected to the computer because I used up most of my USB ports for my printers. And I'm going to revive the R3000. I haven't used it for quite a bit. I've been using it kind of offline because you're able to just, you know, do cleaning cycles and also checks on all of that maintenance stuff through the LCD without having to plug it in through the computer. So I've been taking care of that because I do like that printer, and I want to revive my Workforce 1100, which I had set up with Sublimation Inks. I want to get that going again. I'm sure it is clogged and it will require some cleaning. But what I really want to do with the R3000 at this point is to set it up finally for sublimation. So that'll be a good thing. And yeah, everybody's enjoying the post that I did about the New York Magazine featuring this channel, among others. And so the only difference is that I'm the only free one. Everyone else is actually offering, you know, photography related classes for money. In other words, seminars and that sort of thing, and also online courses. Everything I do is basically for free to you guys, for you guys to grab and enjoy, and hopefully get some knowledge out of it. Whatever I learn, I just pass on to you. It's not that I was born with any of this. I learned it the hard way, just as everyone else has to sort of go through that process, if you will. So let's go ahead and see how many people we already have. We have 35 people, but only about 30, well, about 30 are very shy. Okay. They just don't want to say who they are. So please, please, please tell us who you are. We need to know that. Tell us, of course, this is the routine. I want to know what printer you're interested in. What aspect of photography? Why are you even here to listen to this old man talk about photo printing? Again, share that with us, because everyone else here will be very interested. Believe it or not, they will be interested in why you are here and what are you interested in. So, I mean, I don't want to, you know, go off some topic that may be totally unrelated. I hope I don't do that. Let me go ahead and close this. I want to prep my screen here for something I'm going to be doing as a video, but I'm going to very quickly go through this and show you a little bit later once we get a few more people here. Hope you guys enjoyed my, I think it was Thursday evening, I did a kind of unannounced live stream concerning the Pro 300 from Canon and my views about it. Again, it's kind of two-sided, great printer. It doesn't really offer astronomical features per se, but if it's the first pro level quality printer you own, then yeah, it's a damn good printer. So you should consider getting it. If this is the very, very first printer you want to get into and you want to be able to print without any kind of problems, because it's almost going to do this for you automatically. Mm-hmm. As long as you use like Canon papers, and those are listed in the driver. Believe me, the driver is already pre-programmed for those papers, and it will actually use the matching profile. So you will get a color managed workflow simply using the default settings. Of course, you got to realize that you still have to kind of match or meet other requirements, such as monitor calibration, so that you know what you are seeing, your images, that is, all of your work. Everything that took so long to shoot and compose and create is being displayed correctly to begin with. So when you perform your edits, and I say this a million times, when you perform your edits, it will really mean something. You will not be trying to like subconsciously adjust for a misrepresentation of your image by your monitor, which may be too blue, too bright, too whatever. Okay, so you need to bring that over to a standard. The only way to do that is with a photo spectrometer, spectrophotometer, I should say. I have both the i1 Pro 2 and also the Color Monkey. The i1 Pro or i1 Studio, I should say, is the same practically. I think it has a different color chassis, and I think the internals may have been updated. Who knows? Nobody really says. The software, however, is much better than the original Color Monkey software. I don't have that connected right now. Remember, I had to fully restore my computer. For those of you who may be interested, I lost my boot sector and I didn't have it. Yeah, I didn't have a backup. So I went ahead and, on top of that, I couldn't find my original disk. Yeah, so I had to shell out some money. I got a USB bootable version of Windows 10 Home, along with, of course, a code to activate it. And it was as simple as ever. Once I took out my hard drive, the faulty one, the one that was corrupted, I actually put it on an external compartment and plugged it into my wife's computer. Actually, that was last Sunday. And I copied all the important stuff. And of course, once I then reformatted my hard drive with no partitions whatsoever, I created my proper partitions for Pro for Windows 10. And we're talking about the Pro 10 later. Windows 10, and then I went ahead and reinstalled everything. So it was easy. It was actually quite easy. The Adobe products, I actually subscribed. So I was able to just download everything at once. And of course, once you enter your name and your password, everything's handled automatically for you. And you get the very latest. The only thing is that you sort of lose any presets you may have had in the past that you may have custom created. And I did that for an audio preset for my talking head videos over there. So I need to redo that. I got to remember what it is that I did. Today we are drinking Bai. And Bai is one of these antioxidant infusion type drinks. Christopher Walken used to advertise this on TV, and he's a badass. So might as well, you know. It's quite good. Quite good. Got the pop filter installed because I was noticing that I was getting a little bit of a pop sound when I was, you know, saying certain words that begin with a B or a P. So hopefully this will alleviate that problem. I hope you all can hear me clearly as well. So we are up to 48 people. We almost have 50 people here on board. Don't forget to click on that or smash it, as everyone says, that like button, okay? Yeah, I know it's no big effort, guys and gals. Just click that like button. That way, I've been having pretty good luck with suggested videos, especially my live streams that are being suggested. And it is due to the fact that you guys are giving me almost 100% ratio, okay, of likes versus people viewing. So that does help, and it just click on it. I promise you I will not make anyone angry enough to give me a thumbs down. So again, hit that thumbs up and you will help the channel. Basically directly, it's not even indirectly, it is a direct help. All right, let's go ahead and take a look and see who we have here. Remember, just come on board, click on the chat, tell us who you are, where you're from, printer, interest, questions you may have. Again, I really did not have time to prepare an agenda for today. I got one thing that I need to share with you guys. But again, and also, yeah, something about the Pro 100, okay, and what's happening with these printers. I will talk about that in a little bit down the road here. So we have Third Eye View, and I believe that gentleman is also a drone flyer. I've seen him in other drone live streams as well. Peter is here from Copenhagen, and Third Eye View is from Killeen, Texas. And we have Michael Cavaliere, gotta be Italiano, right? From Connecticut. And then we have, again, Third Eye View says, I have a smaller SSD drives. They are very fast and Windows loads in under 20 seconds. Yeah, I am getting boots. I swear, I'm not kidding you. From the time that the flash, the welcome screen comes on, till I enter my password, probably 12 seconds max. It's amazing now that I got a nice streamlined system going without any extra unnecessary files and such. Bruce Campbell, Ohio. Charles Verbruggen from Belgium. Yeah, where I spent 3 glorious years in. My wife bore our only son. Yes, he is going to be the heir to this empire. Yeah, I don't think he cares about this. I think the grandson Nathan is going to, you know, be the one to inherit all of this. Okie dokie, sensational Onosu. Oh, that's interesting. I got to get some reading glasses that are very low power so I can see my screen. We're trying to get into the naval exchange at the naval base to get our eyes checked. I don't want to buy us new glasses, but until then, again, by appointment only, and they are booked solid. So until then, I'm going to get myself some very low power reading glasses so I can really see this. Right now, it's just a bit of a blur, no matter how I orient my head. These are trifocals, by the way. Anyway, Successional Photography from Wales in the UK. Welsh, okay. Nathaniel Booth, as always, thanks for all you do. Thank you very much, Nathaniel. Let's see who else we got. Harold Goldberg, of course, from Richmond, and he's got a Pro 10. Anyone else want to share their printer or the printer they wish they had or are looking to buy? Please share that with us. It's 98 degrees right now outside. I was outside pulling some weeds before I cut the grass in the yard. Tomorrow, hopefully, it won't be so hot. No, not tomorrow, Tuesday. Tomorrow I spend the whole day with Nathan. Yeah, it's a hot one today, very hot. Can't do anything outside. But you know something funny about the situation? I was discussing this with my wife, and I'm sure you guys may agree or disagree with me on this. We are all kind of in a weird situation, and all of these businesses have to develop ways to be able to perform their, you know, their business with you, the consumer. So we like Pizza Hut. We love it. And so I got on my app and I order a pizza. It's about maybe 4 miles away. And they told me 20 minutes. I got in my car, drove over there. I'm here. They have my car, make and color. Within 30 seconds, the young girl was out with my pizza. That can spoil me. I'm telling you, I do not mind this at all in a way, because otherwise I would have to drive over there. I would have to either call it in. Yeah, I would have to get out of my car, go inside. I didn't even lose my air conditioning. Yeah. So it's weird, but in a way, it's really, you can get really spoiled with this new situation. It's kind of like this, you know. I don't know what to say about it. But anyway. All righty. John, wait a minute. We missed a few. See, this is moving automatically on me. Michael Moss from New Zealand. Jeez, that's a long way across the world, folks. Nice to have you, Michael. John Turnbull from Gloucester, UK. And I learned how to pronounce it Gloucester instead of Gloucester, like most Americans do. Sorry. But, you know, since I was there, and I lived in Massachusetts as well, we have a lot of towns over there that are sort of that structure, in like Worcester instead of Worcester, you know. So I did learn how to do that. One of the few things I learned. All right. Zach. Oh, boy. Plasinski. I love that. From Toronto. Pro 1000. Fit Nena. From Houston, Texas. Canon Pro 10. Peter Yorth from, I think he's from Sweden, Norway. I forget. Sorry. Pro 10. Pro 10S. Nathaniel Booth says, I am moving forward with the Q-Image software. It's wonderful. It's wonderful stuff. I use it all the time. And now they have a new automatic way to create even borders. Just enter a number or a fraction, click, boom, you got equal borders. Just drop your image in. Zoom to fill, it just crops it as it needs to make it fit and give you that even border. Assuming, of course, that you want it cropped. If you cannot afford to have it cropped, then you're not going to get that even border because you refuse to zoom to fill. It's just a matter of choice. Sebastian Kloon, Tony Cucciari from Arizona, and he has a Pro 100. Sebastian Kloon from Germany, I have bought last week a sample pack with Hanamuel. Oh, gloss paper, photo rack burrito, and we'll test at the next few days with a Canon Pro 100 OEM ink. Awesome. You're going to get beautiful results, guaranteed. Go on their site and download those profiles. It'll help a lot. It's kind of hard to do because they're not sort of named by the name of the paper. They have some kind of a proprietary, you know, code type name. Is hard. All righty. Media loco, which means almost sort of crazy. I love that name. That kind of paints me. That's me. I actually, no, not media loco, todo loco. I am completely crazy. So, Northern California, Bruce Campbell, Epson 2200, ink for this old printer. Can't find it anymore. Yeah, that's it. Sorry, you are out of luck. One thing you could do, however, buy refillable cartridges from whomever you can find them. They're all the same. They're not going to matter. The only thing you got to look out for is that they are mass produced in China by like a single or maybe two factories in their whole country. Quality control is not all that, okay? So you may have to buy two sets in case one of them leaks on you, literally. Yeah. So you may end up with, you know, two sets and one or two cartridges that are bad, one on each set or whatever. But you will be able to then compose a full working set. And then just buy, you can use your regular K3 inks from Epson. So you go online on eBay and you find these types of cartridges, the T60, okay, the T60 cartridges. You could probably pay, this is 110 milliliters, maybe $30. And then just extract the ink. How do you do that? Stick that in there and pull back. Even if you don't have a special tip, just take the regular plain tip, tilt it sideways a little bit, because the tip of the syringe will press against the poppet. Look, I got ink on my finger. Press against the poppet valve and will kind of make it difficult to suck ink out. So you need to tilt it so that you clear at least part of that surface against the poppet valve. The reason I made these is because I put a little groove on them. I don't know if you can see the fact. There's a little tiny groove, and I machined that. So I don't do that anymore. It's a pain in the, you know what? I don't sell those anymore. You can get them. You can get the plain tips from, just search any of the third-party companies for an Epson so-called priming tip, syringe priming tip. Some of the UK houses have them. I think octoink.co.uk has these with the little groove on them. You just have to order them from England, okay? If you're in Europe, then no problem at all. Then you just use that ink, that OEM ink, to refill your refillable cartridges. You will be all set for life pretty much, because so far, you can still find those cartridges, the large ones. Any size will not matter. And don't worry about expiration, really. You know, it's pigment ink. They're not going to expire. Unless you grossly contaminate them. You know what I've been forgetting? I should be posting these on the actual panel here. Did you build your PC custom? Would you like to hear about yours? I would like to hear about your setup. Yeah, I did 4 years ago. All I can tell you is that let's see, the GPU, which is what I was more interested in because of my editing, is a GTX GeForce 1750, something like that. It's not bad. And then I got about 64 gigs of RAM, and then a i7 something processor. Again, I just didn't even jot that down right now. It's off of my head, but it's pretty damn good. It's a pretty good computer. Not super duper high end like today, but you know, it does the job. I can edit 4K without any lag, any kind of jumpiness when I'm editing and dragging my sliders and such on the timeline. I can edit like 1080p at about 4x the actual time. So a 10-minute video will edit in about 2.5 minutes, will render out. And I'm using the highest bit rate that, you know, Adobe Media Encoder allows you to use for a specific resolution. As far as images, I can load 50 raw images at one time, no problem at all. And so, yeah, it's running even better now. So obviously for 4 years, it kind of slowed down a little bit, but right now it's running like a champ. All right. Ted Summers from London. Luke Poe. Hi, Jose. And to all from Montreal, the old 3880 is my game. I'm perfectly happy with it. Try to learn new tricks and better ways to do things. Yeah, right now my two 3800, 3880 printers are not connected to the computer. I just ran out of slots. So what I'm going to do, since I don't really use them that much, I'm going to keep them alive by using the LCD screen and just performing maintenance every week on it. Wendy Stone from Cornwall, UK, recently bought an Epson SC700. You know what? If anyone here that has one of the new Epson printers, and I think it's only going to be overseas at this point, maybe here in the US, I don't know, is willing to come on and face-to-face with us, discuss what they think, the pros, the cons, what they have experienced with these new printers, I would more than welcome you. So if you are willing to do that, look at the very bottom of the chat right this minute. You will require some sort of way to connect by video and, you know, audio to the internet. And that way you can just come on board. Don't be shy. Everybody here is very friendly, even me. And we can talk about that, just like I have done in the past with some of my guests. So please consider doing that. Also, you got a problem you want to discuss, possibly solve tonight, something that's been maybe a chronic problem or a long-term problem, and no one's been able to help you, this is it. I'm offering all the help that I can possibly offer for free. It's just going to cost you a little bit of your time tonight. So don't hesitate. Just click on that link anytime during the show, and I will bring you in. And let's see, we have Robert Smeltzer from Avenue, Maryland is here as well. And then I'm just going to go each one of these one by one. Then we're going to get into the standard image and what does it mean? Really, what is it that is telling you when you print it? We're going to quickly go through that. I don't want to do a very extensive demonstration or explanation of that, but I will provide you with the links below. And you can go ahead and access that and look at that yourself. And also download it from their site directly if you do not want to do Facebook. And some of us don't do Facebook, apparently. So that way you will be able to access that image. All right. Art Dlareg. Dlareg. That's a hard one for me. That's why I back up my system twice a week. Do as I say, but not as I do. Yes, I know. I know. Yeah, I'm using, what is it that I'm using? Macrium Reflect. I've used that in the past, works like a champ, can do clones, can do backups, you know, intermediate backups, can do a preload button that you can press, a F11 key, and it will access a partition that you have, all of your, you know, your OS already waiting there to be installed. Yeah, I know. I know. You do not need to tell me. Yes, I know. It was my bad. Henry Stoffel from Wells. ME, that is Maine? No. What is that? I forget. Shit. Epson 800, P800 user, considering chipless solution when it is time to refill. Hit Jose's like button. All righty. Yes. Sebastian Kloon, did you have another microphone? The audio quality is a little bit muffled, dull. Maybe it's because, yeah, it could be. And I'm using this. So how does it sound now? No, it's the same mic. And it's just a USB mic. I don't know what, you know, it could be. So we'll just have to live with it at this point. Hi, Joe from Cyprus. This is George, and that is a Greek name, so I'm not even going to try it. Art Dlareg, can I reset CLI 42 chips with orange guard in place? No, you cannot, because it won't simply not fit. It will simply not fit. Let me get the, and I will demonstrate. So you got, whether you have the original guard or not. Let me see if I got one here nearby. I got a bunch of stuff here for demonstrations. So this is your original clip. This is your third party clip. It just will not go in. It just will not go in. It will not go in with this one either. So you have to be at a point where it's sort of like in the low condition, or you can just hold it kind of in this direction. I'm sorry, in this direction, so that at least gravity is not causing any ink from coming out, and just kind of, you know, adjust it. Let me get a cartridge without any ink on it. So here's the chip. So you want to hold it. This is where ink would leak out otherwise. So you want to hold it like in this orientation, and then boom, like that. You get a steady red light and remove it. And then you can put the clip on it and flip it right side up. Any other way, and if you accidentally like squeeze the sides while you're doing this, you're going to get ink all over yourself. So either do it when the low warning comes up, and that way the liquid chamber will be empty and the sponge was not going to be like that saturated per se, so it's not going to cause any unwanted leakage all over your hands. Mm-hmm. All righty. Nathaniel Booth from Baltimore, Maryland. And he got the mug. Yes, he bought one of my mugs from Teespring. By the way, when you guys look at my videos under a regular browser, you may see an offer from Teespring for one or two of my t-shirts and a couple of my mugs. So if you want to have a little piece of me, something to remember me by, go ahead and purchase through Teespring. I haven't seen a penny from them yet. So anyway, I hope you're enjoying the mug. I hope it turned out well. I have no control over their process. I just provide them with the image and the product that I want them to apply that image to. Don Anderson, Astoria, Oregon. I'm waiting. By the way, it's my voice that's raspy maybe. I just noticed that right now. I was outside earlier and that just plays havoc with my throat. I'm waiting for the Canon Image Progress Pro 300 to arrive. Oh, wow. You bit the bullet. All righty. Awesome. Let us know as soon as you get it. You can come on board here and join us and tell us all about it. Jeff Thompson, South Louisiana. Charles says, I have to make a comparison of the Canon Pro 300. It costs $800. Actually, it's like $900 here. And the Pro 1000 costs $1,000. Is the Pro 1000 a better investment, according to me? Overall, yeah, you get more printer. You get more printer for the money. Although I haven't, you know, gotten my hands on a Pro 300, so I really cannot say how it differs as far as output quality, which is what it's all about. You want output quality to be maxed out, and you want reliability. The mechanical reliability of the Pro 1000 is just out of this world. All right, Will Carson, we'll hear from Southern California. Great info on the Pro 300. I hope you mean my previous video. We went through the Canon USA site and went through all the specs, and then I gave you my 2 or 3 cents worth about what my dream replacement for the Pro 100 would be. Okay, I can repeat a little bit of that. We can go over that as well tonight. Jeff Nichols, hi everybody, everyone from Ontario, Canada. I have an Epson 9880 and love it. Never had any problems with it. So 9880 is a K3 autochrome and vivid magenta printer, very large format. I assume that's like what, 64 inch wide. Successional, oh, aren't you adorable? Oh my goodness, I love ladies to come on board. Yeah, they kind of beautify the place. Pro 100 on order, and I am avidly learning from you. Thank you so much. I am glad that I am able to teach anyone. Henry Stoffel, I use computer glasses from Costco. Really great. Yeah, I'm going to have to get something like that. Maybe I'll look up and see if Amazon has some, because that's the way to go nowadays. I saw a picture on Facebook. It actually showed like the ice cream truck. And so that represented when you were a kid and you were excited that the ice cream truck would pass down your street. Now it's the Amazon truck. Yeah. Rusty. All right, Rusty. He is in Wyoming. What are you doing all your storm chasing? I'm a storm chaser. Yeah. Hope you're getting some good shots out there. You're going to have to share those with us. Michael Cavaliere. Epson P800. So those of you who have the P800, how are you managing your ink? Are you using OEM only at this point? Leaf has not unpacked his SureColor 800. And he's got two 2400s. I actually did love that printer. I had it, but I simply didn't have any room. I ran out of rack space, so I sold it. Here's the link, folks. All you got to do is click on it. Don't be shy. If you got a camera and a mic, I don't care about the quality. It doesn't really matter, just as long as we see each other and can sort of hear each other well enough, we can solve the problems. All right. Rue da Silva, thank you for all the printer information. I have a Pro 100 now with PC inks. They are fantastic. Thank you for showing them on your channel. Yeah. And again, remember that the secret to refilling is doing it correctly. Okay, you do that correctly, you will get nearly the same performance. I'm not going to guarantee you color match, because it depends on the inks you choose. The PC inks are awesome, especially the Signature Edition. And I'm not just saying that because Mike may be listening to me now. They are really good. They're just well matched, really well matched. Some people even choose them over the OEM results. R, yeah, I'll just say R from now on. Thank you, Jose. On recent, have not purchased kit yet. Yeah. Just be careful when you are resetting, when you are positioning the cartridge. Somebody wanted to have like a tutorial on how to reset, and I've already done that. I have a playlist for the CLI-42 modifications, flushing, refilling techniques, resetting techniques. So have a look at that if you have any questions about CLI-42s. When you insert the cartridge in, there's this little depression right here, little switch that you have to depress. And that kind of activates it. You're going to plug this to a USB plug, a power plug. You get a cable with it, of course, plug it into the USB, and then you're going to actually line it up. You got that guide built into it and push down. You're going to see a little red flash, then a pause, followed by a red solid light. That means that the data has been rewritten to the chip, telling it that it is now at a full level. Don't jiggle it. Don't get the red flash and jiggle around and, you know, get all kinds of errors. You're going to ruin the chip that way. You'll need a new cartridge. So be careful with that. Again, remember, none of this stuff we're supposed to be doing. I know Mike said that last time. None of this stuff we're supposed to be doing. The fact that we can get away with it, you know, we should be glad. We should be thankful for that. You just got to do it correctly, okay? Otherwise, it's just not gonna, it's going to be a no-go. So you'll be upset. Believe me. Terrell, Kelly Porter, I just bought, have you been here before, buddy? I don't think so. Welcome, my friend. I just bought a Canon Image Prograph 2100. Man, I wish I had one of those. And what's the best way to learn more about this printer and its capabilities? Well, since I don't have one, you're going to have to just search on YouTube at this point. But you know what? The Pro 1000 pretty much... Well, if you learn about the Pro 1000, you will pretty much know how to operate your 2100, except for the things that the 2100 has that the 21 that the 1000 does not. Roll capabilities, dual roll if you spend the extra money, and also the fact that the Pro 2100, 4100, 6100 has the ability to detect what paper type you're actually loading, and it has auto loading. So there's no more of this, you know, getting a skew error or anything of the sort. It's going to load it automatically. It's going to adjust it automatically. And it's going to detect the type automatically because there are barcodes printed on the back surface, and it can actually detect that. As far as color management goes, same as the Pro 1000. So if you want to learn about just basic color management techniques pertaining to the Pro 1000, just check out my Pro 1000 playlist. It's huge. George says, what is the difference between Lucia pigment inks on the Pro 10 and Lucia pigment inks on the Pro 300? I think they just basically adjusted the, what did they do? The black, I think they claim that the matte black is denser. I think it still uses, let's see. I think it's the same inkset actually, except for the black. So the color palette itself is the same. So Pro 1000, however, has different grays. The reds of the Pro 1000 and Pro 10 are not exactly the same. Mike Lee mentioned that last week. And can you swap Pro 1000 red on the Pro 10 or the Pro 300? Well, the Pro 300 should be using the same red as the Pro 1000. It's IPF now, image prograph. Got that red line around it. It's the same pro level as the Pro 1000. So I think the reds are the same. Again, Mike said they were, so I take his word. And the grays will not be the same because the Pro 10 has one gray, and it's just called gray. And it's equivalent, this gets confusing now, it's equivalent to the dark gray on the Pro 1, which had three grays. Confused yet? Yeah, I am. Yeah, it's hard to keep track of what Canon does. So, but the other colors should be pretty close. If you're planning on buying, you know, other cartridges to refill your Pro 300 cartridges, then you have to keep that in mind, that there's going to be some slight differences in the chromatic characteristics of a red compared to that red, for instance, or yellow compared to the, you know, two yellows, one for the Pro 300 and one for the Pro 1000. There may be differences. They're not going to tell us that. Loving the Epson 570. What is that? F570. I have no clue what that is. See, I don't know everything. People think I do. I would have to search on that. All righty, let's see what else we got here. Michael uses OEM looking into third party. Well, let's see, what printer were you thinking of? PA100. Yeah, you can do third party, absolutely, no problem. You can install refillable cartridges, absolutely, no problem. They only work one time. Okay, the minute one goes empty, that's it for that one. Your only option is the chipless solution, firmware upgrade or downgrade, whatever you want to side grade. I don't know what to call it. It's just an installation of a firmware that will render everything as being full, like it never empties, okay? Except it does empty. So you got to keep track of those actual ink levels very, very carefully, as you don't want any air to infiltrate the lines. It'll give you a lot of problems. The other option is the chip decoder board. That is $400. You get 30 full resets. I haven't reset even once since I installed mine. So that goes to show you how long a 80 milliliter of ink cartridge lasts on the PA-100 quite a long time. I don't print on it every single day, so again, that's not a fair statement to make. If you do, then you're going to have to go through those inks a lot sooner, a lot quicker. Yeah, that's it. Either that or OEM cartridges. Okie dokie. Let's see. Brother Ernest, I am not using OEM with either the my P800. I have a P900 purchased already, and I'm waiting. I am on the list for it to arrive. Where are you located, Brother Ernest? Are you in Europe? If you are, then yeah, you can use refillable cartridges pretty much the same as anyone else outside the United States or North America. They just cannot, we just cannot do that here. So if you are overseas, then, you know, by our standards, overseas means anything outside the US, of course. We act like we're the center of the world, but you know how it is. Anyway, so yeah, here, no, there, yes. Twenty-four inch sublimation printer. Wait a minute. What are we talking about here? What is a 24-inch sublimation printer? Ernest, please clarify. That's interesting. That would be a hell of a heat press that you would need for that. Michael has a P800. Sebastian Kuhn says, it is a solution to iron paper to get it flat, roll paper or wrinkles or flat on flat paper, and thus the heat destroy the surface a little bit. Capability to take, what are we talking about? I'm sorry, bro. Was that, did somebody bring that up, Sebastian? Where are you at here? I don't know. Okay. Please explain what you are referring to here. What solution are we talking about? What's your favorite aerosol spray matte finish? Well, the sprays that I use don't have a gloss or a matte characteristic. They do not affect the surface. I'm using Moab Desert Varnish and Hanamuel Protectant Spray. That's the name of it. So Desert Varnish and Hanamuel Protective or Protectant Spray. I just used that. Let me show you real quick. The breathing color vinyl. It's not stretchable vinyl. Like, oh, sure color Epson. Oh, okay. Oh, wow. Holy cow. Awesome. Now I get it. Okay, you see this material? It's vinyl. It feels like a window screen. Okay. And I made this for my son. He loves all these characters. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to attach two dowels, top and bottom, and then a string. He can hang it by his closet door. But this is a material. It's really nice. It's matte, but it has a bit of a gloss when the inks are applied. I'm using matte black, of course. You do get a bit of a sheen. And I already sprayed this to protect it. So I still got about 8 feet of this material loaded in my PA-100. It's pretty neat. I just want to come up with something else to use it on. I don't want to waste it just for fun. All right, that is one heck of a sublimation printer then. So I assume you have a big heat press. What, how many colors does it use? That would be fantastic for the large aluminum prints. Oh my goodness. Thank you too, my friend. Brother Ernest, Boston. Okay, so, oh, you bought a European PA-100. Wow, yeah, you're in, no problem. George, compared the ICC profile gamut volume of the new Epson P900 to the Canon Pro 1000 for the same paper, and Canon Pro 1000 wins over them. What? How did you get a ICC profile for the same papers? It's a third-party paper, right? The Canon Pro 1000, period. Yeah. Anything over, let me just say this, because a lot of people comment about, you know, gamut volume, and that's just a straight number. In other words, if you take your 3D gamut comparison, basically you're going to get, it's not a circle, it's not a sphere, it's kind of a weird shape, almost geometric in shape. And you have white, you have black, and then you have RGB and MCY. And how big that thing, that it looks like an alien, actually. How big is that determines how much volume is inside. Let's call it that way. So the larger, the more further out it extends, the higher the gamut volume you have. So, and it depends what areas actually extend more than others, you know, concerning those six colors. And of course, how high up does it go, all the way to pure white? Does it go all the way to pure black? Okay. So in order for you to be able to see visually, actually see the difference with a semi-demanding image, the standard image is a really, really good one to use because it's neither demanding and it's neither a blah, you know, very dull, low resolution, you know, pastel, gentle image. It's actually pretty good. You need to have at least a difference of 15%, okay, gamut volume. If you have the ability to examine or view an ICC profile and view its 3D shape and then read the actual numbers and be able to determine, you know, the volume of each comparative ICC profile, then it would have to be a difference of, you know, 15% or more. Anything less than that is very hard to really discern. So, you know, don't get too concerned about that. Don't really get too concerned about that. The fact is that on most normal images that we shoot, you may not see the difference. Now, Pro 1000, of course, with blue. Now, the P900 with this violet ink, which I think is the same thing, will increase your gamut a little bit. We'll be able to print out those really awesome deep purples and deep blues, where the regular nine color Epson P800 just simply cannot reproduce those colors. It just cannot. Yeah. Media Loco. You said media, so that means female. Are you female or male? I really don't want to intrude, because in Spanish you would say medio loco, like I'm medio loco, you know, and you would be media loco, media loca or medio loco. I don't know. Anyway, I'm trying to figure it out. Thinking of restoring my Artisan 1430. Do you have one? I have a 1400, which is basically the same thing. And I'm using refillable cartridges. I'm using Precision Colors inks. They have a brand new ink set for it. And all you got to do is maybe if you have, even if it doesn't respond to cleaning cycles, give you a nice full nozzle check. You can do the soaking of the printhead over very carefully folded three layers of paper towel with some Windex soaked onto it. And you just unlock the printhead by... It's a process, okay? Let's see. You have to turn it off. You turn it back on. And then once the printhead gets detached, you pull the plug off the wall. And now you can slide it over. You position that strip of paper toweling. And this is, of course, if clean cycles do not solve any clogs you may have. You perform your next higher invasive process, and you go higher and higher. You start with the least invasive, and then you slide the printhead over that folded paper towel. It's going to be like a strip about that wide, maybe three layers. So if you got the paper towels that have a half a sheet, like three layers, and then you cut the rest off and soak it really well with Windex. Put it on your platen, and with that crunching, you know, that paper towel, you slide the printhead over so that it floats over the paper towel. The fumes will start to dissolve any dried ink. And then you perform another cleaning cycle and also check. If that works, you're set. Then you can install refillable cartridges on it. The only other process will be a lot more invasive. It requires you to remove all the cartridges and actually insert a piece of tubing on the spigot of the printhead. The printhead on an Epson of that family will have little tubes. Here's the printhead for a Canon printer. It will have little tubes that stick vertically, and you put a piece of tubing. It has to fit, so you have to go to a model airplane shop, a hobby shop, and find some tubing that will fit that. And then a syringe. Attach the tubing to the syringe, Windex, and then very, very carefully, without any force, back and forth, on that channel that may be clogged, that's not responding to anything else. If the other ones are clear, there's no need to perform any of this onto them. So just leave them alone. Six-color printer, yeah, it's fine. It's not a Pro 100 for sure, but it's just fine. Sebastian says, the iron question, no, it's a question because I have Epson roll cut into pieces on my Pro 100, and sometimes at the end of the print, the printhead have contact with it. Yeah. What can you do about that? Oh, man. It came from a roll of paper. It pretty much has that built into its memory. Yeah, it's a pain in the you-know-what. It is just painful to deal with, and not much you can do with it. You don't want to put any kind of liquid and then iron it flat or any of that sort. You will affect the coating. The coating is made of sort of like a gelatin type substance. You don't want to do that, believe me. Except for your cheap resin coated papers. But just counter curl it. If you can get it, you don't want the curling to be up. You want the curling, if any at all, to be down, okay? Away from the printhead. So if there's anything you can do to minimize the curling, at least get it to go down and not up, because then it will be stricken by your printhead or struck. Do you have on-site training? What do you mean by that? This is my on-site training. I really do not. Kaltari. CLI 42 Canon cartridge. I just did the rejuvenating fluid for Canon sponge card per your recommendation. Drained it after 24 hours. Now I'm letting them dry. What is the gram weight after drying? 14 or less, let's just say. Okay. The rejuvenation fluid has a little bit of glycerol or glycerin. And once you remove all of the, it's basically alcohol, water, and a little bit of glycerol. That glycerin is an emollient, so it will actually attach to the fibers and allow ink to very easily come in. It's not going to come down to a bone dry weight because of that residual bit of glycerol that will be left behind. Glycerin does not evaporate, okay? So it'll always remain there. But again, that's why you only use something like 0.5% or something like that. I forget the actual formula. Why would you do this? Because if you refill every time by letting it go past low, lots of air will infiltrate, okay? It starts to form like a foam inside that sponge, and nothing can get past that. Liquid cannot get past that. So at some point, that cartridge just stops performing, and you have to just start from again, from scratch. Flush it out and then treat it with that solution. And that way, then you suck out all the liquid and you blow air into it, whatever you need to do to get it down to as minimal amount of fluid in it, and let it air dry. If you have a food desiccator or a food dehydrator, put it in there. Like whatever the temperature is for dehydrating food, it may be 100 degrees, and just let it dry. let it sit for overnight or a whole day, and until it's not going to lose any more weight, in other words. Bone dry should be about 13.6, 0.7, 0.5, depends on the sponge. Those sponges are not exactly the same weight, so they will differ up and down a few fractions of a gram. So, all right. We made it to the bottom. We got 62 people. Wow, that is really awesome. I am amazed. Okay, so let's talk about the Pro 100. And the bad news that I have for you, actually bad news, good news, it's becoming scarce. It stopped being produced. So the only Pro 100s available are being sold for premium prices, folks. Premium. Let me load this shocking page on here from eBay. Let's see what else we got here. Yes, we got two pages actually. We're gonna go ahead and share this one. And this is what's happening. This is on eBay, folks. They used to be available for $100, $120, $150. Let's go ahead and see if there's anything under $120. Yeah, if you want a used one, maybe. No printhead, no ink. Mm-hmm. So let's go ahead and just remove that category. You want our inbox printer. You're going to be paying $450. Gosh, isn't that like retail price? Yeah, so there's going to be a lot of people scalping you. This is open box. This is on a bid. There's 20 bids right now, $150, $250 current bid, and $38.79 shipping. There are five more days. This is going to go for a premium price, guaranteed. $275 for this one, brand new, complete. $270. This is what used one. $111. That's on bid. That is not buy right now. Let me change that category. Let me see if I could. No, let's see. Where's my filter? I can't find it here. Let me hear. So, no, anyway. So, yeah. They're gone. So what's left is what's left. Just thought I'd let you know. This is no printhead, no ink, just the body. People are selling the brand. Now, someone recently, look at that. So these are all new and $295. That's close to, you know, $600 for this one. Check it out. $345. Not even in box, pre-owned. Amazing. Here's another one. Pre-owned, no printed, no ink. $575. So that's the current situation, folks. It is insane. Totally insane. Let's take a look at something else. Let me load this one up. So this is my local Craigslist. It includes Washington, D.C., Virginia, and Maryland. Got one, and how much do they want for it? Does that even say $300? And another $300, and another $300. And this one's not even new. That one's not new. So yeah, that is the situation we are currently in. Isn't that something? Let me look at Pro 100 printheads, because someone contacted me not long ago wanting to know if they could get a printhead for the Pro 100. And I almost said, hey, geez, just check on, you know, on eBay. You'll find one. And then I kind of held back. Then I had to go check myself. So Pixma, throw 100, print hit. Let me, there you go. Okay. Let's see what they have. Let's see what's available. All right. So we have new inbox. It doesn't even show up in it. There's only 12 results. $41 for the unit itself. New. You know. Here's the thing. The print head will die long before the printer will. But if you have a print head that is absolutely fine, and you're one of those that every time you print, the print head perform or the printer performs a cleaning cycle, you may have filled up your internal paths already. So in this case, for $41 and God, $114 shipping. Oh, that's a bid. That's not even the real price. That is ridiculous amount of money for shipping. You see where we are at this point? Do you get me now? This is a bad situation, folks. $350 for a printhead. Like Yoda was going, Yeah. $350 for a printhead. Here's another one. Buy it now. $130 shipping. $50. It doesn't cost $130 to ship that printer. Believe me, it doesn't. $49, $328 shipping. What? Yeah. You see where we are? Look at $400 for a printhead. So if you have, it just goes on and on. There's no end to this. So let's just go ahead and, before I get more depressed, let's just go ahead and close that off. Are you shocked? I am. Yes. So here's the thing. What's left is what's left. There are scalpers out there. There are speculators, even local Craigslist. Unless you're just, oh my God, the planets are aligned just right and you find one for a reasonable price. And by that, I mean 150. Believe me, back when they were giving these printers away with a camera purchase, people were selling them for $100. Okay. And they got them for free, absolutely free. No cost involved. They even shipped them free. So yeah, what's going to happen to the Pro 100? Well, hopefully we get a new one. What will the new one include? Here's what I want. I'm going to tell you what I want. It's not going to be that big a problem either. It will not require any kind of ridiculous amount of retooling. You have, and why would we care? And this is what I talked to Mike for an hour and a half, a couple of days ago, actually, in the middle of the week. And we talked about this. And I said, Mike, why do we give a you-know-what about a new Pro 100 when we got this Pro 300 out? It's got Chroma Optimizer. It's got 9 colors. It performs a great job with most images on just about every kind of media, whether it's matte, glossy, fine art, I don't care, even canvas. Why do we need an upgraded Pro 100? And he said this. Let me put these over here so you can print on this. What's so special about this? This is only 20 sheets, by the way. And it's not that cheap. It is so freaking glossy. It's almost like it's wet. If any of you did any darkroom work or back 30 years ago, you heard of the term Siva Chrome. That's what that looks like. It looks like a Siva Chrome print. It just had this almost 3D appearance. and only a dye ink printer will be able to perform that illusion, if you will, of your images. Only that paper. Your regular glossy papers, I don't care how glossy they are, will not perform like that. So that would be the only reason. So, okay, I said, okay, fine. So I'll forego printing on matte media. I know, you know, the dye photo black is just not going to really perform that well, not like matte black can. So here's what I want, okay? And it will not be a big deal to produce. And I'll pay a grand for it. I'll pay $1,000 for it. Okay, 13-inch capacity, that's fine, no problem. But I want you to, just like the R3000, it has these two little slip-on roller adapters. They hold only a 2-inch core roll. There's not that much out there. You will really not find too many rolls of 13-inch wide paper that come on a 2-inch diameter core. You may have to buy four-inch core rolls and re-roll them on a current, you know, core. I've done that on a 2-inch core. I've done that on the Photo Stylus 2200. That had a roll adapter that actually worked, and it could cut paper. It had a front adapter for the cutter, and then it had a rear adapter for you to put your roll. Yeah, the lowly 2200, no one can find ink for. I kicked myself for having gotten rid of one of those. Gosh, I wish I had one. I got rid of everything. That was one hell of a printer by Epson. Slow as molasses, but who cares? It performed beautiful. And it had that roll capability. And the driver was all set up for that. Okay? So anyway, long story. So yeah, just add that. You don't have to give me a cutter. Just have it print a line, just like the P800 does. That's all in the driver and firmware. That's it. These guys can write anything, whatever they want on that driver code and that firmware code, believe me. So give me that. And then give me, I don't know, 128 inches max. I'll never use that, but you know what I mean. That way you can print and print and print. If you have QImage, you have raw capabilities on QImage that no other program does. You can just print until you run out of paper, and you have paper all over the floor. We won't go to that extreme, but yeah, I want that. So we have 13-inch capacity with a roll adapter. That's just a slip-on system. Put a little bracket in the back, slip those roll adapters in place, 2-inch core. If I have to hand roll my own paper, I don't care. You already have a manual feeder in the back, so that would be no problem whatsoever. Okay? That would be so simple. Okay, now, what about, internal calibration, densitometer? Yeah, call it IPF, okay? Image prograph. Put a red band on it just to bring it to that level. Put an internal calibrator. You did not do that on the Pro 300. You left that out, so it's not going to be professional level as you're trying to make it sound like, okay? If that was the case, you would have put an internal densitometer, okay? We'll leave that one floating. That's just a pipe dream. Okay, forget about the densitometer. But printhead, I want 10 channels. Oh, impossible. Bull. You already have this one. Okay, 10 channels. This can use dye inks. What you got to do is rework this so that it matches the round port of a CLI 42. Okay, this is meant for the CLI, for the PGI 29s, 72s. So they have a different port. This is just something you need to retool, okay, big deal. And that way we can load the following ink palette. Get this. MCY, okay, and then Photo Magenta, Photo Cyan. That will give you 5 channels already taken up. red, green, and blue. That gives us 8 channels taken up. We have 2 more, black and gray. Okay, that black, make it denser than the normal photo black. Oh, that will distort. No, it won't, because you can create a print engine that will then reduce the need to use real black, because you will be compositing 98% of your black tones with the other colors. Yes, indeed. Okay? That gray will still give you the ability to print monochrome images. The gamut will be immense, because you have proprietary magenta, yellow cyan, photo magenta, photo cyan, and black, of course, and yellow, of course, and then 2 blacks, 1 full black, 1 gray, and then your RGB, red, green, blue, proprietary colors. That way, you don't have to composite a green, because you will be mostly using real green ink. You will not be compositing red, magenta, and yellow mix, because you'll be mostly using red. That's what the Pro 1000 does. That's what the Pro 10 currently does with red. You will not be compositing blue. Blue is more like a purple shade, so you would need magenta and cyan to create a true blue, not a sky blue. That's cyan. Sky blue is not blue, it's cyan. So again, that will give you the ability to just go beyond the capabilities of compositing. Okay, not all colors can be composited. They do a really good job, okay? But they will do a better job by having true red, green, blue, and still have 2 blacks, and make that black a little bit denser, so then you can print on what? On matte media. That would be perfect. Oh, one last thing. I demand to be able to change, I don't care how small it is, a waste ink cartridge, and charge me $25 for it. I don't care. I want to have that ability. I don't want my printer to stop working because I've saturated my internal pads. They're buried down there. They're taking up space. Use that space a little bit wiser by creating a little trap door on the side that you can remove a replaceable waste ink cartridge. Okay? Just like the Pro 1000 and the others. They have that. I don't understand why the Pro 300 doesn't have that. I just don't get it. For as much as they charge for it, I don't get it. What do you guys think of that? What is your opinion on that pipe dream of mine? Yeah, 10 channel. Oh, and make it. Give it that automatic skew correction that the Pro 300 has as well. We need that as well, because we're going to be loading roll, remember? Yeah. And if you want to make it more expensive, then put that internal desktopometer. Make it a little bit bigger if you have to. I don't care. People complain about space. Set up a table dedicated to that printer. That printer will probably be the last printer you buy, because it will perform that well. Okay? Yeah. And I don't know. I think that probably is way too high of a demand, and they will probably eliminate any other models that they are working on, because in order for me to buy something new to replace what I already have, it's like people with iPhones. My God, do you really think that the iPhone you bought last year is not the one you really wanted? Sure, you wanted it because it was new, and it had this. They had another one already ready to go for the following release, and you got to have that one too. You're not satisfied now with the current one. The same thing with Pro 10. Why am I not satisfied with my Pro 10? Of course I am. I don't need a Pro 300. What is that going to offer me image-wise? Nothing at all. Anyway, enough of that. Let me see here. We have a bunch of new people here during my yap. I cannot understand why. I don't know if I put this up already. Yeah. Yeah, the same price almost. It is crazy. Kaltari, I assume that's from Hawaii. Mahalo. Vincent Joe. I'm a Joe also, so thank you so much, man. call me Rick. Yeah, I'm gonna call you Rick from now on. Can I just top up OEM cartridges with PC SE inks except yellow? Or do I need to flush? Yeah, you can top them off, except for the yellow. They're going to give you a CLI-8. You see this one here? This is a CLI-8. It's the same cartridge, exactly the same. I need to take this chip off, and it's kind of a pain because the chips have an open slot and then a closed slot, and those little posts were sort of melted in place. They call it a weld. So what you need to do is you need to really take a close look at this. This one right here is the one that's open. So you carefully with a razor blade, slice off that little welded spot and then lift the open end and slide the chip out and then put the new one on, okay? And the CLI-42 yellow chip from your cartridge will replace this one, okay? And you could use silicone to hold that in place. You're never going to have to remove it anyway. So that's all you have to do. The other cartridges, you can actually wait until they're empty. Do not waste your OEM ink the first time. Let them go till they're empty or near empty. Perform your modification and refill them right there on the spot. Okay. If you're not sure about how long it's going to take you to perform that modification, buy some pre-modified cartridges, okay? You cannot leave that printhead unattended for more than just a few minutes. You just have enough time to actually do a physical exchange of the cartridges. It's going to move over to the right again. You're going to have to redo the whole step again. It's not really recommended, let's just say. So when you're doing your initial modification, and you only have one set, your original set, you got to do it really quick, okay? You're going to cut out that circle. I got videos exactly showing you how to do this. You're going to find the depression where the ball sat at one time. Let me see if I have an untampered one. I should have one. Here we go. So this has not been tampered. This is OEM. It's only been used just to create some test prints during my comparison between OEM and CLI 42 SE ink. So right about here, if you feel it with your hands and look at it, you see a little bit of a circular indentation. You take an X-Acto blade, number 11, scribe the outside, remove that piece of plastic, and then either with a push pin, stick it into the ball and pry it off, kind of lever it off. And then you have to drill it out to a 5/32 inch diameter. Do it straight. Do not go in angles as you are drilling, and you will end up with an enlarged hole, and that plug will not seal any longer. You'll have leaks all over the place. So this plug has to sit sealed so tight that it goes actually through it. You see how it goes through that actual internal seat of the cartridge? That's because you drilled it out. Without drilling it out, the plug cannot pass through, and it will not perform the seal that you need. If you don't have a good seal, it'll just leak uncontrollably out of the cartridge and into your printhead. You don't want that. It's a nightmare. I bought 15, P600s in the past 3 months. I did a live in your Facebook group trying to show you. Now I can sell them for $1,950 unboxed. What did you do to them? And please send me a PM showing me where you posted this, because I really need to look at what you did. What did you do to these printers to be able to sell them a 1950 unboxed? Oh, European ones. Okay. All right. I got it. Although the P600 may not be, those are not P600. Let me think again. Yeah. P600 US printers are not locked. Okay. I hope you knew that. Only the P800 European ones. ND Coach 29. You know, I'm really horrible at these abbreviations. SMH. I hope that means you're giving me a hug or something. I don't know. There are no more Epson P600s on eBay. Oh, okay. Yeah, you can speculate all you want right now. You can sell them. Yeah. Okay, so yeah, I'm glad you got the to do that, something like that. That's wonderful. More power to you, my friend. Go for it. I bought these live in your group. I told you I was trying to corner the market. Oh, okay. I didn't see that live. I'm not on it constantly, so I missed it. I just bought a Canon PIXMA Pro 100 printhead on buy, or I guess that's eBay, for $127 shipping included. Good. I hope it is sealed in box, my friend. Sealed in the actual Mylar wrapping. There's too many people just screwing people over. Media, local movies, movies, music, books, and such. Oh, media. Okay. See that? When you said local, I assume it was media, which is mostly. Yeah, otherwise full local. Yeah. Well, join the club. Great idea. Tell them, Jose. Thank you, my dear. George says, great wish list about the Pro 100, but would you still buy it if compatible inks were a no-go? Here's the thing. Canon doesn't really lock you out, okay? Canon still allows you to disable ink monitoring, which then allows you to use an on-monitor cartridge. It still uses the chip to identify the color. You just will not show a level any longer. And it's your job from now on, that point on, to just monitor your cartridges yourself. Yeah, so you still, that happened after the suit where Epson got really taken to the cleaners over the fact that some of these consumer level printers, not the photo printers, this was not over photo printers as we know them. This was over your consumer, you know, all-in-one type printers. They were declared empty and there was lots of ink left. So they got sued over that. And Epson lost a lot of money. So Canon just doesn't want that. So if you want to squeeze out, whether it's good or bad, example, when this goes empty here, the liquid chamber, there's going to be about 3 to 4 to, depending on the saturation level, especially if you have refilled, they'll be saturated all the way to the top. Just like this. This one's already been tampered with. It's saturated all the way to the top. This one's untampered. You see the difference in saturation level? This is what OEM looks like, untampered. So if I want to squeeze out the last drop of ink out of that sponge, which is not recommended on a thermal printhead, I would disable ink monitoring, continue printing until I begin to see streaks on my prints. Not good. Okay. Don't do that. If you're going to refill, don't do that. But anyway, that's the reason they allow you to screw up, but it's on your own. You're on your own after that. So that they are not under some kind of liability that, oh, we're declaring your chip empty, but we're having you throw away 5 milliliters of about $5 worth of ink right there. You see, they don't want that. So they made it very easy for you to disable ink monitoring. Whether there are chips available or not, or a resetter or not, we'll still be able to use third-party inks. That's what we did on the Pro 100 years ago, before RedSetter made it resetter for it. We just disable ink monitoring, okay? And every once in a while, you remove the cartridge. The only problem was, dig this, every single print was preceded by clean cycle, every one. It wasn't time, it had nothing to do with any kind of length of time, it had nothing to do with any kind of residue buildup, nothing. Every single print was preceded by a cleaning cycle. Yeah. So thank God we got a resetter for it. Nadine W, I just switched on. Do you recommend the Pro 1000 instead of the Pro 300? Yeah, if you have the extra money, the Pro 1000 is a better performer, period. 12 colors, okay? Well, 12, 11 and clear. And wider paper capacity, you have other features that the Pro 300 just simply does not have, internal calibration to bring that printer to factory specifications that it's not going to have out of the box, okay? My problem is your favorite modified cartridge supplier says that he doesn't ship to Canada. That's a problem, yes. I'm sorry about that. That is not having to do anything with me. That's all with him. So, and with the border closed, I cannot cross border to pick up. Yeah, I get it. There are no more, Joe, there are no more Epson P600s in the market. I cornered the market. Good for you. I'm glad. I hope it works out for you. Again, like I told you, man, Pro 100s are selling for the original retail price now. So that's amazing. Vincent Joe says, Jose, how can I protect my image printed on glossy paper using Pro 100 from fading? What kind of gloss? What kind of ink? OEM? You know, they'll last pretty much until you get tired of them. The OEM inks from Canon, for the Canon Pro 100, are amazing. You can put them under glass. Any cheap frame will work. Let me show you. This is my awesome grandson, Nathan. This is on Paladuro soft gloss rag and Pro 100. I tell you, this looks as dense and beautiful as it did. He was only, I think, 5 here, maybe 4.5. He's 8. 8 going on 40. At least he thinks he is. And it hasn't faded in the least. Now, that's really good paper. It's not your RC coated, full of OBAs type papers, but just a cheap $5 frame. I think I paid $5 for that frame at a Goodwill. Yeah. So other than that, a UV spray, what you need to do is just seal it against UV and against ozone from the air. So if it's RC coated paper, the back is already sealed, so only the surface has to be sprayed. If it's a good, like Moab Desert Varnish, Hanamuel Protect and Spray, those are the ones that I use, and they're really good, and they don't affect really the look of the surface too much. But they will protect your prints. If you're using a third party, then, you know, the longevity goes down by tenfold. And then you really have to do something specific. Now, that one, is third party, is Precision Colors, but not the new Precision Colors inks, the older one. We haven't determined yet if there's any difference between the new yellow that he used and the new black. So, yeah. And, you know, it depends where you live. I mean, you know, if you live in a very industrial, high ozone area, you'll have a higher degree of fading. I don't seem to have that problem here. So, I'm glad. Yep, we have certainly hit the end of the road. There's new printers coming out, but, you know, whether we're all into third-party support, whether we refill with OEM inks from other sources or not, you still have to have a cartridge system that you can refill. The Pro 300, sure, it's the same as this. Exactly the same cartridge as the PGI 72. Easiest cartridge to refill. none bar. I mean, everything is more difficult. This is so simple. Flip it upside down, remove this, and drip fill until it weighs 32 to 33 grams, and it will differ. And then what you do is you squeeze the sides to remove any air bubbles. Boom, done. Clip it, you're ready to use. You reset it before you refill, because you can run these till they're empty. I'm sure that Mike showed you guys the internal paddle system that it uses to agitate the pigment inks, keep them nicely suspended. P600 on eBay right now for $742. Yeah, that's like a ridiculous price. You know what? Murphy's camera, I swear to God, they had them for, I think it was $90 one year. You had to call, talk to a Tom, or I don't know who it was, and get it for $90 plus shipping. Seriously, it was ridiculous. That was like 2 years ago, maybe 3 years ago, Christmas time. Not new, he says. Yeah. Because he's got them all. Open box, new. Okay. Yeah, open box could be anything. Epson 7 P700 has been available for a while in the UK. P900 still listed as pre-order. Wonder why? I don't know. No idea. I wonder why they're available there sooner than here. That's a weird situation. We'll leave it floating as a pipe dream. Yeah. That's my perfect printer. I think you're going to be the new dealer now. Yes, indeed. Likewise, Nadine, glad I was able to help. It is an outrage. Yeah. Gotcha. Nadine says, is it true that the Pro 2000 and the Pro 4000 don't do cleaning cycles as often as the Pro 1000? That's what I have been told, okay? I don't know whether it is due to the fact that the cartridges are held in a different position. They're actually held upside down. So let me look at a Pro 1000 cartridge. Here's a Pro 1000 cartridge. Now, they feed the printer a different way. So it's subtle, but if you look carefully, so this is the front. This is the part that inserts into the printer. Notice that the floor slants a little bit. Let me tilt it this way. You see that? So this container is full with about maybe 5 milliliters of airspace left. You need that gap. And it basically gravity feeds into the system. The Pro 2000 and up is this way. You insert them straight down. I've been told that's the difference, but I don't see how that has anything to do with clean cycles. I think it's just more efficient. I don't know. But yeah, that's what I have been told. Okay. And Rusty is here. Actually, no, he was here, but he's in Wyoming chasing tornadoes and whatever. But he has a Pro 4000. And I know I asked him last time he was actually on the panel here live with us, not last week, but I think it was the previous week, whether he had noticed anything. But again, he had a Pro 1000 and he has a Pro 4000. So I wanted to know from the horse's mouth, if you will, whether he had detected any differences in the frequency or the amount of ink being used for cleaning cycles between the two printers. I don't remember whether he did tell us or not. But so far, that's what I have heard. Why don't you like drilling separate holes next to the ball? Yeah, that's because, it's a very simple answer. That's because the factory filled hole has about a 1/8 inch deep wall that actually helps in the sealing. If you drill a hole, you're only drilling through about maybe a little bit more than a 32nd of an inch wall. Okay, so you're not going to have as much area squeezing against that plug and sealing against it. You have to have a perfect seal. Okay, if you're going to drill a hole, you might as well remove the ball and just clear out that seat. All you're doing is reaming the seat out to 5/32 diameter. That's it. You're not really drilling a new hole. I have one here that's double drill. In fact, this one, you see there's two holes. For using this one, if I stick this through this hole, the one that's drilled on the side, there's not that much surface. I bought this from someone. I can't even stick the plug in that hole right now. I'm not able to do that. The hole was drilled in the wrong diameter. What I'm saying is that the surface area, the inner wall of that hole, is much less than the nice factory molded hole. And all you're doing is drilling out the seat or reaming it. Okay. You're not enlarging the hole. You're not manufacturing a new hole. You're just reaming out the smaller opening of that bottom seat. It's kind of it holds a ball in place, and the ball can rotate in there. That's why. Yeah, it's a little bit more work, but much more reliable in the end. And we want as much reliability on our, converted cartridges so that they perform as close as original cartridges do without them being tampered by us. I want to give them to my children, Jose. Yeah, that would be a hell of a gift. John Turnbull says, in the UK, the P600 is going for 700 pounds. Is that pounds? Yeah. New, that's about 850, 880. Wow. Hago or Hago Pig 2000, hello from Toronto. Pro 100 protein using species signature inks. Toronto, you're right next to Mike's business. He is right in that area there, across from the falls. Herbert L. from San Antonio, Texas. Can PC inks be used in Canon PIXMA 8720? Well, you go to the site and look and see if they support that printer. Yes, of course they can. Depending on the colors, you look at the category. What is it again? Let's go ahead and look at PC. I will check on that for you right now. If I could find it. Here we go. All right. So let me pop this over there. Here's the weird way that you search through his channel. Let me go ahead and remove that. So we have 8720. So how many colors is that? You have to tell me. Is that 7, 8? Tell me before we move on. Thank you. Thank you, Rick. Now, I need to know from Herbert how many colors that printer has, because I need to know that so that I can do a search on his site for Canon. See, I need to know how many tanks the printer has. So we can go, for example, if it's 6, let me see. 6. So we'll hit the 6. Now, give me the nomenclature of the cartridge itself. I need that as well. So what kind of cartridge? You see the different types here? Do you see your type there? If that is the case, then yeah, they support it. In the meantime, let me go ahead and check out this other post. Yeah, so someone has already used them. So there you go. That is your answer. Yeah, no problem. As you see right there, you see that? some of these cartridges are reusable in other model printers as well. So, and someone already vouched that they have used them. So that should be no problem then. Let's see what else we got here. Any news about the chip on the cartridges of the Canon Pro 1000? Yet none. None. We're still basically replacing them one by one as we empty them out. I'm about to do that. I got about four or five colors. I just recently, like I said, redid everything. I reinstalled all of the printers. It was a piece of cake on Windows 10. I cannot believe that. Say what you will about Windows compared to Mac. It was a piece of cake. Okay. Yeah. I remember it not being so in earlier versions of Windows, but it took maybe less than a minute per printer. Yeah. It took longer for me to search for the, I have a folder with all of the drivers for all my printers, and it took me longer to do that. I actually downloaded a few that I thought may have some updated drivers, and that was a piece of cake. The minute that I had them, here's what I had done. I had them all plugged in, but I had them turned off, basically. So they're all through a hub system that I have. And so every time that I had to install one, I would just power it on. I would hear the little notification, boom, done. After I installed the driver, go back, turn on the printer, or connect it via USB, boom. Within 30 seconds, I'm done with that printer. I thought it was going to be a pain in the neck, but it turned out to be so easy. Okay, with the Pro 1000, no, you have to use single-use chips every single time. The so-called auto reset chips just did not work. I think you will pay like $12 per chip. George says, can you mix some OEM ink cartridges with precision colors cartridges in the Pro 10 without affecting quality? If you mean that, you know, you could have, say, 8 OEM and 2 precision colors, sure. There'll be a certain little bit of a transition where you will see differences, because it's not a perfect match. None of the ink sets are a perfect match to OEM. What I suggest you do, this is a recommendation by me as well as Precision Colors. If you print on glossy, any third party chrome optimizer is like 1/10 the quality of OEM. So if you have to splurge and you have a need for chrome optimizer, if you print on nothing but matte, then really you don't have to worry about that. But the chrome optimizer that everyone is selling in the third-party world sucks, okay, including his. And so he recommends that you buy OEM chrome optimizer cartridges. Other than that, yeah, you will have a transitional period. That's the way it is with most systems. The good thing about the Pro 10 is you'll see it instantly, because there's no ink lines. There's no highway worth of ink lines that, you know, that ink traverses slowly through it and you see a gradual change and something sneaks up behind you. No, you will see it instantly. All right. I'm going to be doing a video where I am going to discuss this. Let me put myself next to this. There you go. And simply, this is what we all use to verify our printer. What time is it now? We got about an hour and 15 minutes. So I hope we can, hour and 15 minutes. We'll go till 7. And so this was created for you'll be able to basically test and check the ability of your printer to perform as you know, meant by the factory, basically. So I'm sure this is a very easy to recognize image. Hope everyone of you is using it. This is the best that they really have. Now you can download it right here. If you don't do Facebook, You don't have to go to my Facebook group and join, although I recommend you do. Download it from there. You'll get it, and it is a Profoto RGB image. You're meant to open it. When you open it in Photoshop, make sure you are working inside Photoshop using the Profoto RGB color space. That needs to be your working color space. Otherwise, it's going to alter the image, okay? It's going to convert it to sRGB. Good Lord, that's the last thing you want to do. So let's go ahead and explore something different here. So this is an explanation of what each one of those sections covers. Let me see if I can do this. I can enlarge it a little bit more so I can see it a little bit clearer. So simply, Bill Atkinson is going to go ahead and, you know, basically tell us what each one of these sections does and how we should be interpreting the results that we get. So when you print that image, the first thing you should look at is this ramp. And it's a gradual ramp. It's not in steps. It's just a very gradual ramp. The reason we want a gradual ramp rather than one composed of, I don't know, 250 something, you know, 55 steps, is because we can see if it's a smooth transition. Your printer's print engine will dither. In other words, will mix all of those little dots. And they come in various sizes, by the way. They're not all the same size dot. Sometimes you need a larger dot. Sometimes you need a very small dot or ink volume. In other words, it'll be in the picoliter type of volume. And so you're looking for smoothness, and you're looking for also a linear neutrality. You don't want it to change tone from black all the way to pure white. You want it to stay neutral. So here's another section that has patches. And you see the difference here? This is what you don't want to see, okay? You do not want to see a change in tonality. And again, I'm just going to very quickly go through this. You can go to it yourselves. Let me go ahead and copy the link so that I can post it for you. So we'll go ahead and put this on the chat. And I'll put the other link as well for you. Let me see if I can. No. Anyway, once you get to this, you can backtrack and go to the main page and download it, unless you're downloading it from my Facebook group. All right. So this one here, again, it just shows you your steps from black, which will be here. This is two. So level two out of 255, which is right here. One is like if you took black ink and just poured it on the paper. And white is just paper out of the box. Nothing has been applied to it. So you have your two extremes. You want to have a representation of a 2, for instance, as well as a 254, for instance. Okay, what is that one? Yeah, 253. Actually goes to 254 and then 255 is a pure white. So you want to have somewhere, maybe like from step number 4 all the way to maybe 253 with, you know, where you can actually discern those steps. And you may have to backlight that print, okay, to be able to see that. So if you're able to see that, you're really ahead of the game. Now, let me go over here. This one here, this is more like a torture test. So it goes from full saturation, red, green, blue, all the way to black, and then from full saturation, red, green, blue, all the way to white. And the same thing now with yellow, cyan, magenta, all the way to white, and yellow, cyan, magenta, fully saturated, all the way to black. So again, you want to have a very smooth transition, okay? That's what you're looking for. If you see a little bit of a band somewhere, that's fine. That's really not going to affect most of your images. 99% of your images will really not be affected by that. That just means that your printer just simply cannot dither from, say, from here, maybe to here, just a little bit lower. It just cannot do it. So you're going to see a bit of a bend. Now, here we have just a bunch of color patches. Okay. Be aware that the ones on the top, are not going to be printed correctly. They're way out of gamut. If you do a gamut check, these are full gray, way out of gamut. They are over the cliff. Okay. They're there because at some time in the future, when printers reach that level of quality, that level of gamut, maybe they will be able to reproduce some of these. So you see that there's hardly any difference here. You may see a difference in your actually printer results. Okay. This one and this one will definitely show up on printers that have a dedicated blue ink or violet ink in the case of the new Epson printers. Then you have another ramp, neutral ramp. Now, if you are a portrait printer, if you are a person who prints nothing but people faces, then you need to look at this very carefully. What I have noticed in some situations is that this highlight areas print normal, but the shadow areas just have this very slight kind of a bluish tint to it. It's almost like a fogginess to it. And that will show up on a bad profile, okay? That, for instance, you're using an OEM profile and a third-party ink, and usually you solve that by creating a custom profile. By the way, I do that as a service. I have a pack of new charts that somebody sent me, so I'll be doing that pretty soon. And by the way, it's for a 2200, an Epson Stylus Photo 2200. Moving up to the top corner, I look at the sky gradient. So this is a perfect sky. Basically, it goes from a middle cyan, and it just slowly graduates to practically a white. You don't want to see banding there. You do not want to see any banding. The yellow. Aspen trees give us the area of bright yellow. So remember, you only have one shade of yellow in your ink palette. Most printers don't have a dual yellow, like a dual magenta, dual cyan, or dual blacks with grays and so forth. You only have one yellow to deal with. That yellow has to be used to create greens, oranges, reds, you name it. And compositing to create a neutral result when you print black and white as well. You use your blacks, but you also use your yellow and your magenta to remove any kind of lack of neutrality you may encounter. That's when using advanced black and white on an Epson printer or black and white mode on a Canon printer. So that's important. So you want to look at that and make sure that you have a nice, let me see what it says, pleasant tonality, as well as a really fine higher contrast detail in the trunks. So again, you got this image, go ahead and print that on your printer. Don't let Photoshop adjust it. Don't let Lightroom adjust it. Anything adjust it. Print it on a paper for Epson or a paper for Canon. On a Canon, if you're using Windows, I don't know what it's like on a Mac, but if you're using Windows, you're going to click on the box that says Color/Intensity Manual Adjustment, then Matching tab, and then set it to ICM, usually the middle setting. So none would be if you're going to let your application use an ICC profile, whether it is a custom profile or one provided by the paper manufacturer or the driver for that printer. All right. The CD player shows both shadows, details, and the handling of metallic tones. That's important. If you are shooting something that has a lot of metallic tones, going to a car show, for instance, you're going to an air show, and they have all of these aircraft parked, and you're going to take some close-ups, and it's aluminum everywhere, okay? You want to be able to reproduce that aluminum so that it looks like aluminum and not just gray tones, you see? You have to give that look, and you will be able to discern that by printing this or by examining this portion right here. The strawberries. The strawberries are a famous part of the image. They have to look like you want to eat them. Now, let me tell you something. OEM Pro 100 ink. I don't want to bash OEM. Okay. but the signature edition inks from PC outperform OEM when it comes to that particular part of the image. On OEM, using OEM profile, in fact, OEM everything, those strawberries look a little bit toward the orange side. Hold on a second. Let me see if I can pull this out. I have it right here. And I'm going to go ahead and go full size again to share this with you guys. Here we go. Hang on a sec. This is it. Yeah. Let me go ahead and jump back to full me. See this beta fish? You see the bottom one? This is all printed. Okay. Let me explain. Printed with the driver controlling color using the ICC profile, because if you choose ICM, it's going to do an automatic match to the profile for Pro Luster. Okay. So I'm letting OEM everything handle the process. Okay. The only difference is the inks. So the bottom one is OEM ink. The top one is PC. There is a difference in quality. And the top one is better. Shocking. It is a shock. Okay. I didn't notice that until Mike brought it up, because somebody had brought it up to him. He missed it as well. The reds of the edges of the fins are red. They're orangey on the OEM rendition. Okay, so I know what you're asking. Well, Jose, how do they look like on your monitor? Yeah. This also includes, by the way, the upgraded cyan ink. For that level of quality, be able to reproduce those really strong cyan colors. So what can I tell you? I mean, what else can I say? It's awesome. All right, let's go back. Let's finish up here, and then we'll do the last few items here in the chat. And then if we have nothing else to talk about, we'll go ahead and sign off. But maybe I'll go to my Facebook, and there's a lot of stuff I could be. I probably have enough for about 5 hours. I don't want to keep you guys here that long. That would be criminal. So let's go ahead and look at this sunset. This is another one of those images. So the saturated orange sunset generates a halo and gradient that can cause banding issues with a bad profile. Okay, keep that in mind. So the little circle that represents the sun, that'll be probably a specular white. So it'll probably be a 255 tone. Just outside of that, sometimes you get a green halo. Okay, that's a bad profile. Okay, sometimes the sensor of your camera produces an image that looks like that. Okay, that's just part of the problem. Sensors cannot reproduce everything 100% faithfully. So keep that in mind when you look at this part. It's not just a pretty sunset. You need to look at the transitions between the edge of that pure white sun, especially here in this part of the sky. Okay, so then on the lower sections, you have a lot more transitions. You just want to have nice, smooth looking transitions. Okay, so this looks like, I don't know, like lava that's solidified. Yeah, lava rock has both deep shadows and a metallic bronze highlight. You want to be able to detect that in your print. The highlights should look bronze metallic, not just green or yellow. You can use that patch to compare the shadows performance from different profiles or printers by looking inside the lava folds with a loop. Oh boy. So you see, it's not just, you know, a simple image. And this is my favorite. This is an electron micrograph. Last is the black and white image. In the center, the patch contains a full spectrum of grays from full black to fully blown paper white, while the carved surfaces are, this is not carved, this is an EM picture, have smooth gradations of varying lengths and show how the printer handles gray transition areas with a real image. So again, this image basically is going to outperform like anything you can throw at it. So if it performs really great with that image, you have nothing to worry about. You have nothing to worry about. Your printer will be ready to go. In other words, let me go ahead and load something else that I need for the end. So yeah, that's what I always say. When you set up your printer, before you even think of printing one of your images, you need to print that one first. And that will tell you everything about that printer, okay? Whether it can perform as you hope it does, you know, right out of the box without any kind of influence from anyone or anybody. Let's see if this is what I want. I need the one where I say goodbye to everybody. Where did I put it at? Jeez. Yeah, let me show you something else here. This is interesting, but I need to find some of these images on my drive. I thought I had that open. I guess I do not. Oh, here we go. Nope. Nope, I guess I just don't have that image anymore. Okay, so hope you guys didn't leave me just because of that. We got 54 here still. Here's another problem that happens. And let me show you a real honest to goodness nozzle check. Before we start making comparisons. This is from the Pro 10, since we're talking about Pro 10. And then this one, Pro 100. Okay, notice perfect bands all the way across. The width of these bands constitutes of lines. It's constituting, it's made up, I should say, of lines. Each line represents one nozzle. They look like a smooth band because of the dot gain, the wicking action of the paper. So you should print your nozzle checks. The ones that you really want to examine, like if you see any problems with your color rendition, you start seeing like a streaking or anything like that, or all of a sudden things have a color cast, run a nozzle check. If you see this, good Lord, let's go ahead and take a look at this. So this is on a, I think this was on a, this is a 90, good Lord, what is this? Yeah, a 9500. So it is this printed right here, 9500. You're gonna notice it has green and red, okay? So that's what I mean. That particular printer did use two proprietary primary colors as well as your secondary colors. So, you know, if they could do it, why can't the new Pro 100 do it? You know, just reuse this print head on it, but retool it so that it can use those cartridges. It's going to be fantastic. I'm talking like it's going to actually happen, but it's not. All right, so what do you guys see here? I showed you guys this one in the past. You have three channels that literally have half missing, or at the very least, half density. Let's just say the photocyan, you got full density, half density. Magenta is full density, and I think that's gone. And the regular cyan is half gone. Yeah. That's not a clog. That is an electronic failure, okay? And it happens. Another thing that's really weird. Look how bright the yellow channel. That's like twice the brightness it should be. Okay. And these, they don't really show a difference, do they? Same density, and gray even looks darker than photo black. There's a problem here. Not only is the printhead not working anymore correctly, these cannot be fixed. You cannot fix it. Now, if you ever see this, if you ever see even a single channel with half of it gone, that's of course a failure. But what caused it? Did the printhead cause it? Or did the printer cause it? Okay. And the sad thing is there's no way of telling. There's no way to really know whether the printer caused it or the, you know, the printhead itself decided to go south. So to fix this, if it's the printhead absolutely, you know, guilty, then you replace the printhead. And as you saw, Pro 100 printheads are expensive, as you can imagine, and just about any other Canon printhead right now is just astronomically expensive. What do? You just toss the printer out and start again. Sorry. Because if you change that printhead to a new one and the motherboard is the guilty culprit, it's going to also damage that new printhead. So it's a catch-22. You really don't know what the cause is, so you really cannot diagnose properly, you know, the situation, and you end up blowing several hundred dollars again on a new printhead only to have the same thing happen. So that's, I just saw this on my folder, so I decided to show you guys. It is a problem that can occur, all right? Let me go ahead and take that image down. Okie dokie. Let's see what else we got going here. So if you guys want to just, let me just go ahead and search for the Outback image. And there's another one that you can download. Actually, that is just as good. So this is the actual website for the images. And I'll go ahead and show you what they have available. And I got a bunch of other really awesome images that you can use. So there's this one here. Of course, that's the most widely known one. And then there's this one as well. And this one has a, not a gradual ramp, but one that's divided into vertical steps that you can actually use to check. It has the same basically components, same basic components. This one here is actually the same. It's been compressed a little. This is a new image. Here's a new neutral image here as well. Now, if you go to Outback site, the big, I don't have that link with me. It will take you to a section where you can actually download specific standard images for just monochrome printing. And I got those available as well in my Facebook group. Actually, you can just download the whole pack in one swoop. And it will help you if you just want to concentrate on just, you know, black and white images or monochrome images. You can just go ahead and get them from that. Yeah, I think we, I think, except for the gray, I don't know what gray the Pro 300 is using. The Pro 1000 uses a photo gray and a gray. So does that gray match the gray on the Pro 10? I think that would be my only question. But as far as everything else goes, I think it's a pretty much a match. Jeff Thompson had a remark, but I don't know what he was remarking about. No mention of longevity. Who? What? The green cyan patches are better in the PC profile as well. Canon profiles show a green blob, but PC has separation of the green. That's what happens with my custom profiles as well. I end up with a better result. Will a bad print hit damage a new printer motherboard? I don't know if it works the other way around. I don't know if it works backwards. In other words, I really do not know. One of those mysteries. By the way, we have close to, let's see, let me add a few more people here. We have 4,597 members on the Facebook group, and I know that we have three new ones, so we'll add those. And our grand total now is 4,597 still, okay? That's weird. Just added you guys. How come you're still the same? Weird. Nope, 4,600 members. Awesome. It just updated. Yeah. Let me see if there's anything interesting here. I'm going to go ahead and I'll leave the live stream notice up a little bit longer. People have been having problems with outages. So let's go ahead and talk about that a little bit. So I think a lot of you all rely on these types of units. And again, if you're in an area that suffers from a lot of storms, yeah, it's a good thing to have. Severe storms are pretty rare in my area here. I mean, we get them all the time, but it's not super severe. I think I had a little bit of a blink of the lights the other day, and I haven't noticed anything for like 2 years. I have one of those. I just have 13 printers. I really don't have enough to house all the printers that I have. But maybe if I get a second one, then possibly I can plug them all in and be all set. Talking about cameras, we don't do cameras so much, but I'm not gonna get upset over that. Oh, this was the other day. We're going to delete that. We don't need to have that anymore. All right. Mystery problem. Suddenly, all new files created in Photoshop are all completely off color when printed, while existing files still print perfectly. Remember what I told you guys about sudden changes? Okay, like sudden changes in results. It doesn't happen because the printer decided to output differently. It's caused by you somehow. Somehow your settings, and this is from a Mac, unfortunately. Yeah, I hate to say it. Something you did, and she is working. I don't know if it's a she. Yeah, Claire. sRGB. You know why? You are choking your gamut. Okay, so imagine if I print my standard image out of Lightroom, for instance. Lightroom is not going to take that image and turn it into some other working color space. It's going to print it as is, and then I go to Photoshop and open it, and I have it set to sRGB. And behind your back, unless you have a specific set of little tick boxes ticked, is going to convert that image to the working color space. It's going to take away and throw away 50% of your colors down to sRGB from Profoto RGB. And you're going to end up printing that. Now, existing images that you had will not be affected because those, you know, were already edited and treated as you wanted to under that particular color space. So I think it's a whole situation where there's a color space mismatch here. You see the difference here? And again, it's all workflow related. Same thing here. So double profiling is another one. Look at the difference. I'm sure this is correct and this is not. I'm sure this is correct and this is not. So double profiling basically means that both entities, in other words, your editing software and your printer driver are both trying to control color. This is why I recommend using QImage. QImage will not allow that to happen, especially in Windows, where everything has to be set manually. Mac does not allow double profiling, so I don't know how that person even managed to do that, unless they're working on a Windows machine. But if they're working on the Windows machine and using QImage, that will not be allowed. QImage will automatically either turn color management on in the driver or off. And if you're printing color patches like those over there for profiling, then neither entity can control color. So when you're printing regular photographs, either QImage controls color or Photoshop or Lightroom or On1 or whatever you're using, but not the driver. If you let the driver control color, then none of those other applications can be controlling color. You have to set it to let the printer driver control color. Okay, then that job is sent over to the printer driver, not Photoshop, not Lightroom, not anything. QImage Ultimate will switch those settings for you. But you just switched it over to letting QImage Ultimate control color. I just turned it off on your driver. It tells you that. You get a notice. I got a video covering that. Go to my QImage Ultimate playlist. Check out those videos. If you're not sold on that software, and I don't care what anybody thinks. I'm not getting money or anything like that from them. I've been using it for almost 2 decades now, and I have nothing but good things to say about it. Anyway, for me, I make mistakes all the time too. So I could possibly be double profiling more than I'm willing to admit. But now it's impossible to do it. It's just impossible. If I'm printing color patches, it's impossible for me to screw up. If I tell QImage off, that means don't control anything. Open it and print it. Nothing can be done to that set of patches. It will print incorrectly. When I choose off, it also turns it off in the driver. Then I can print that set of color patches raw. I can scan it, and I can guarantee that your profile will be as good as you can possibly expect. That's the thing about that. So if only for that, I mean, a few other features. I don't use it for editing at all. I use it for printing. And there's, as far as I know, there's nothing better. It's the most economical solution for calibrating your monitor. I wish you could just do it with software, but software will fool your eyes. You need an unbiased eye, and that's this or the other one, that big one over there. One of those. You need a spectrophotometer to make profiles as well as calibrate your monitor. But if you just have the need only to calibrate your monitor, you can get away with maybe something much cheaper. In an I1 display, I mean, X-ray display, something like that. It's a Color Monkey display, I think it was called. It's just over $100. So something like that will get you calibrated. I just calibrated this monitor tonight, by the way. Quite an involved process with the I1 Pro. But yeah, there is no really economical way. You still have to shell out some money for either a colorimeter or a spectrophotometer if you want to do both monitors and also create profiles. And that one, the I1 Pro, can actually profile my scanner. Let's see what else we got here. This has nothing to do with printing. It's one of those paper cutter machines used in crafting. Oh, here's my the thing that I posted on the New York Magazine. If you guys want to take a look at that. Hopefully it'll help the channel, maybe get some more viewership, more subscribers. That will increase the exposure. Canon Pro 10 versus Pro 100. Do they use the same amount of ink to print, or do you get more mileage out of a pigment set? See, that's a misunderstanding from most people. Let me go back to me. We got half an hour to go. Let's just put it this way. Okay. So to print something like this, let me get the even if it's not pigment versus dye. Let me just get the PC. Yeah, here we go. So I have one printed on ProLuster. And I have one printed on Breathing Color Rock River Soft Gloss Rag, I think it's called. It's a 300 gram paper, very stiff. Pro 100, both PC inks. Okay, if I was to print this the same exact size, one of those papers would use a little bit more ink than the other. Okay, ink density is required depending on the type of surface coating your paper has. Okay, so some papers require just more ink density. So let's just say that in a square inch of a given color, you would need slightly more of that color than on another type of paper. And you would still see the same visual density, okay? It's just that that paper will require more liquid ink to reach that density. Don't ask me why, but it happens. So how can you compare then pigment versus dye, when the paper also has a lot to do with it? Generally, let me see, this is letter size, but it's not edge to edge. So if I was to print a standard image on, you know, pretty much, but say a quarter inch border all the way around, almost to the edge. So that standard image would require 1.5 to 2 mL of ink global, whether I have only 6 colors or whether I have 12 cartridges. With the Pro 1000 Chrome Optimizer, I would be using that for that sort of lustrous paper. So yeah, about 2.5 to 2 mL. It's not an exact science, so it's hard to tell. The dye printer pretty much will match the same amount of ink per print, okay? It's just that you have more colors, more cartridges in the Pro 10. You have 10 of them. You have 8 on the Pro 100. But total ink volume used on a standard image, on a letter size paper, pretty close to the edges, in other words, let's fill it as much as you can, it'll be about the same amount of ink, okay? Same paper, same printers. You know, I mean, same paper, but different printers. So if I switch over to another paper, it would require slightly different amount of total ink, maybe more, maybe less. When you configure a paper so that you can save it as a new addition to your list of papers using the media configuration tool for the Pro 1000, for instance, you're going to run a test. You're going to determine what is the minimal amount of density required for that particular unknown paper you're configuring, okay? So it's going to run patches, and then, so let me put it this way to make it simple. If I'm running a black, a medium gray, and a light gray, and I run it, I actually use a high ink density, and I start reducing the ink density as I print copy after copy after copy. At some point, you reach a point where all of these, they didn't change, okay? But from this point onward, they started getting lighter. So the correct ink density level would be right about this point here. Where over here, they start getting darker, let's just say. That's what I should have said. It started getting darker. And over here, there are maybe two or three steps where they don't change. And after that, they begin to get lighter. So somewhere around that region, there is the correct ink density. So you save that. You want the minimum amount of ink you need to acquire a maximum black, a perfect middle gray, and a very, very light 254 or 253 white. Lightest, almost imperceptible gray, okay? So that would be your ink density setting, and that gets added to the thickness of the paper, how wide the gap has to be, all of that stuff. So just because the paper is called a luster paper, doesn't mean it will require the same density as ProLuster or some other luster or this and that luster. All of those lusters will require different ink densities. They will all use a total different amount of ink for the same image, same size. You see? So there is no perfect answer to that. It's one of those questions, again, that there's no answer for. Anything else here? Let me see. Freehand, are you going to preview the new Epson printers like you did with the Canon 300? Yeah, I could do that. I'm not going to have them here on hand, but I can go ahead and look at the specs and then compare the two. Output-wise, again, just like the PA100 compared to the P600, output is identical, okay? Print engine changes, they may have some differences. Color-wise, it should be about equal. Detail-wise, maybe slightly different. But I'll do that. I'll do that. I will check that out. I'll go into the Epson US site and see what they have posted as far as the specs. I mean, I have the previous family of Epson printers here with me, so I can do some comparisons. Wombat Arrow, I love that. Hi. Are you just gotten here? We're about to say bye-bye. Michael was just looking at the new Canon Pro 300. Cannot use roll paper on this printer. Yeah, you can use... you can use roll paper, but you got to cut it yourself. So it's that kind of situation. And it's just like the Pro 1000 with the new firmware. You can extend the length, and you have to cut down your sheets of paper from roll. You're going to have that permanent, you know, bend and curl, especially when you get to the last few feet closer to the core. That curvature is going to be even more intense and more difficult to remove. You can't reverse roll it, or you're going to then cause kinks on it. So, again, the only way to print is to at least get the longest sheets you can possibly get, or cut your own and then hope for the best that you don't have any kind of a curling problem. Now, the good part about it is that the curl will always be away from the surface, so it'll be downward and not upward, where it can catch the edge of the printed, like most prints head strikes occur. They occur because they catch the edge of the printhead. So let's see what else we got here. All right. It's hard to see sometimes from the photographs that people post, but there's some banding here. And I am not surprised. It happens to be on the sky. It's one of those mysteries. We do not know why that occurs. It will not occur anywhere else on that image, only on the skies. Isn't that strange? At least I have not come up with a solution for that or a reason. It has to do with, for some reason, blues and science. And I think it's a fault, as far as what Mike has told me, it's just a fault of that particular color. I don't know why. Let me see what else, if anything, came up with a good answer to that. Would that be noise in your photograph? No, it's banding, actually. Not sure why it would be creating such a pattern when printed, though. So, I mean, all I can suggest when something like that occurs, run a auto head alignment and hope for the best. And then print at the highest possible quality. If your printer allows you to use a unidirectional printing mode, choose that. Okay, so here's why you need to calibrate your monitor, folks. This is a classic case right here. If your printer is working correctly, I just repeat that. If you print your standard image, letting the printer driver do its thing, okay, default settings, use a paper for that printer. Choose this, you know, the color mode that says the printer driver is going to, you know, control color, in other words. On Epson is basically just like an ICM. It will match that profile that your driver installed that matches that paper. You will get a perfectly neutral standard image print. Then you print your own images. Then you get this result. Can you see the vast difference? It's your monitor. Your monitor needs to be calibrated. The image that you printed, the standard image, you did not edit, so you did not alter it, okay? And it looked perfect visually. You look at it. Now you go and print your images and you edit them because, hey, I want it to look like this. But the printer's really getting this image. This is really the image the printer's getting. The printer has no choice but to create what it receives. I know it's hard to accept, but the printer will create what it receives, okay? If what it receives looks like that in real life, yeah, not like this. This is on an uncalibrated monitor. That's why it looks like that. This guy wants it to look like that on print. It's not going to be because it really looks like this. It's just being displayed like that. You see what I mean? So your monitor totally needs calibration. Look at all the answers from people. I hope they help them. This is an odd one. This is a P9000. That's one of the new ones. That's a Sure Color printer. He got it from a warehouse that sells like one of these recycling places. And apparently there is some sort of password you need to reset the printer with. And here it is. And only the administrator can do it, whoever that person may have been. I think he's screwed. He's going to have to contact Epson and see what they can do for him. 8 foot by 12 foot canvas. Wow. We won't even get into that. That's way beyond what I can possibly even dream of doing. Red text prints as burnt orange on a Canon Pro 100. Well, it's text. It's not color managed. Okay, period. Blunt answer, but it's true. Word is not color managed. Most websites, most browsers are not either. Picture viewer from Microsoft or Mac, any kind of picture viewing software in the Mac OS or the Windows OS is not color managed. I would not dare open a standard image using Picture Viewer. It would look totally off. So yeah, don't be surprised if that happens. Print a photo and create your letters in Photoshop and it will print correctly, whatever color you make them to be, but not in Word or not in any kind of word processor. Okay, so picked up a Pro 10 for $250, only 100 pages printed, but it has a clogged print head, photo black. Anyone use Windex or something stronger? Right now it's soaking in distilled water. Just use Windex. See how they took the printhead out, lay it on a tray with some paper toweling below it, add some Windex, and then dribble Windex from the top, and it will go right through. If it does not go through, it's clogged, okay? There's not much you can do about it. Now, let me leave you guys tonight with this last reminder of what Mike had told us last week, of a new method that he's been using. So normally, to attempt to clean a Canon printhead, and these are the ones that require the most help, you cannot take apart an Epson printer printhead unless you're a mechanical wizard. These are easy to remove. Simple matter of removing the cartridges and then unclamping the printhead itself and removing it. You're going to place it over a tray, a plastic tray, anything. Put some paper towel to cushion that. You don't want to touch that with your fingers. You don't want to touch that with anything other than soft paper toweling. And fold it into various levels, layers, I should say, and then add, like, I don't know, that much Windex. You don't want to get it into the electronics back here. You see that green plate with all those contacts? You want to avoid that. You may want to put a piece of, plastic or some tape on it if you want to keep it safe. And as it is sitting there, just get a pipette or an eyedropper or a little bottle like this full of Windex and dribble it onto those ports, just like that picture showed, okay? This picture right here. Just dribble it right on there and just let it sit and keep monitoring. Lift it up and you can see, you're gonna see colors coming out of the bottom, ink, residue. And you might see that one of those little ports just goes down. The liquid just goes right through. Continue adding that. Change your layers of paper toweling. Continue changing. You know, a bottle of Windex costs about $4. So that'll be a very easy fix if it works. And continue doing it until you see no more ink coming out. Okay. And as long as you see the Windex draining through, and you see that there's only blue stuff coming out of the bottom, like Windex, cyan, then you can proceed to then use just distilled water. Change everything again, and then fill the compartments with distilled water. Let it drain off, let it drain off, let it drain off. Once you are sure that all the Windex has been removed, take it out, lay it, you know, maybe like this, and let it air dry completely, okay? Completely. Reinstall it, install your cartridges, preferably refilled, and then run a cleaning cycle. It will run a cleaning cycle, massive cleaning cycle, and then a nozzle check. And if you get a perfect result, you're done. If you still do not, after all of that, then you can use a water pick. And that was something that Mike was talking about. He uses that for the worst possible unclogging procedures, and that's a last resort, okay? You don't want to use that straight out of the bat, okay? Straight off the bat. A water pick will work like a power hose, a power wash, okay? It will remove stuff off of surfaces. That's why they use it for plaque removal. So put it at a very low setting, and you can start blasting those channels right there. And then blast from the top, blast from the bottom. Again, gentle. If it's 1 to 10, only 3, okay? Nothing more. And if that doesn't fix it, then you got electronic problems, or you got actually physically damaged printed nozzles that are just, you know, that's the end of that printhead. And as we saw, printheads are not easily obtainable anymore. Even the source that I had is charging up the wazoo for printheads. Lucky for me, I did manage a new one for my current Pro One. Cost me about $165. And if my Pro 1 decides to go kaput as far as printed goes, I can go ahead and replace it. I don't know about my internal ink pads. I really don't know what condition they are in at this moment. That's all you can do. You can just hope for the best. Okay. Cost of printing, go to Red River website. Yeah, they have that available. Again, it's you know, so-so, depends on your image, because not only does ink density have something to do with it, the amount of ink, but the density level of your image also has a huge effect on how much ink you use. So if you print, let's just say, a polar bear in the snow, and you edit it so that the snow is over to the right of the histogram and a couple of little areas of black, you will hardly use ink. Black cat in a coal bin, that's, you know, that's going to use a ton of ink. Okay, that fish picture, this one, that used a ton of ink. Okay, because that black background was really not created so much with black ink. It was created with all the other colors, compositing. A deep black, and then black is used to even make it a little bit deeper. So yeah, that would use a lot more ink than, say, that, you know, the polar bear in the snow. Thank you again as well, Mike. Nice to have you here. Can you tell us what is your experience concerning gloss differential? Are pigmented inks suffer more or less than regular dye inks? Dye inks are absolutely liquid, okay? There's nothing else but molecules dissolved in a fluid media. So when they are applied to paper, regardless of the surface, it penetrates the layer, the ink receptive layer. And it is transparent. In woodworking, we have pigmented dye stains and also dye, transparent aniline dyes. The aniline dyes allow the grain of the wood to just show majestically through the stain. Pigment dyes do not. They actually somewhat block the grain, okay? So the same thing happens with ink. So what happens is, because you have particles, literally little pebbles, they're microscopic, but they're still little pebbles. They create, and they sit on the top surface of the paper. They sink a little bit, but they don't really penetrate like dye inks do. So they sit on the top of the paper. And if you were to look at them microscopically, you would see a rough sandpapery looking surface. Well, sandpaper doesn't shine, does it? It's coarse. Matte paint for your wall is coarse, macroscopically. There's no other reason why matte paint, wall paint, looks matte. It's because it's rough, okay? And that roughness takes light and diffuses it. It lands in straight parallel rays, but then it just bounces off. So there's no shine to it. Whereas glossy, a mirror, bounces the rays pretty much the same way they came, parallel. They do not diffract, they do not diffuse, and they continue looking, you know, the surface looks glossy. So different pigments have different roughness. And so they will have a different look. If you could just paint with magenta, cyan, you know, yellow and black, black would look really glossy. Magenta would not be so glossy. And the other two would be somewhere in between. That causes gloss differential. Now, another cause of gloss differential would be, for instance, in this case, if you look at this with me, you will notice that the background has the same level of gloss as the black, the red, and the yellowish parts of the fish. There is no, regardless of what angle I view this in, it's perfectly even gloss, perfectly even. Had I not used gloss enhancer, such as Chroma Optimizer, you will see the difference. The background with no ink will be a lesser gloss than the areas with heavy amount of ink. You would immediately see that difference. Sometimes in a highlight that is perfectly white, like for instance, right here, right at the front of the dorsal fin, that is pure white. If I did not have gloss optimizer or chroma optimizer, that little area of white would look duller. So yeah, you need a print. If you're worried about that, get a Canon printer, not an Epson printer, okay, period. The new Epson printers, I wish they had added some kind of gloss enhancer. Did they? I don't think they did. They added blue or violet. So, but yeah, gloss differential will occur differently on many types of paper. Some papers it hardly shows, and some other papers it shows drastically. Can you put it under glass and does it disappear? Well, yes and no, it depends. You can still see it if you hold a frame at a different angle. Same to you, my friend. See you next week. Hope you all have a great, fantastic week. What do you recommend to advertise for my printing and build a market? I don't know. What are you selling? You know, that would be the only thing. What are you selling? Well, folks, I think that is it for now. Let me see if we got anything else on YouTube. Let me quickly do a couple more on YouTube here, and we got 10 more minutes. We can spare 10 more minutes, absolutely. All right, Luke Paul, you were here tonight. Let me go ahead and put this here. We'll get rid of the Facebook group one. We'll put this up. We'll go ahead and cover this one last, actually two more. So last week with Mike Lee, we covered a so-called torture image. And let me look it up. I think I have it in my picture folder. Let me view this as a list. Test images. And we'll open up this one here. There you go. All right. So this monster right here will torture the living daylights out of your printer. You print this sucker, and it will also, especially if you're refilling, it will tell you if you're suffering from ink starvation or the inability to produce good, smooth transitions. So again, this is available in my so-called Facebook group. It's all there for free for you guys to grab. So if you suspect anything, especially also here are some lines that are basically closer and closer and thinner and thinner and thinner. I think they go down to like 1 pixel thickness or width. So you can check the ability of your printer to be able to print sharp detail. And notice they're at different angles as well, because that will make a huge difference at the angle. So you could look at that printed on, say, a good glossy paper, then use your loop and take a look at these areas here to see what's the smallest separation between two lines. In other words, you want to see a black line and then a white space and then another black line. And it could be, like I said, a pixel apart. And if your printer can produce that, in other words, it doesn't just blend them together, then you know you got a good thing going. And if all of these transitions are smooth without any vertical banding, then you know you're good as well. So that is one of those really awesome images that I have available for you guys. And again, this guy is wondering about that particular image as well. You know, don't be afraid of joining Facebook, because you will be able to find all of these freebies that I have there for you guys. I download a bunch of images as well from other sites that are free to be able to be used. There's no any kind of controls on them. And I often use them because they allow me to, you know, use them for testing different features on printers. Let's go ahead and look at this. Oh, by the way, somebody did ask, let me do this one first. Can I buy a full set of flushed CLI-8 cartridges and then swap the chips? Okay, like I said earlier, yes, the answer is yes. But why? Why not just, you know, modify your own? And you don't have to do any kind of chips swapping. You may install them slightly crooked, and then they will not be recognized. And you're wondering what the heck is going on. Just buy a set. If you live outside the U.S., there's nothing I can do to help you. You will have to do, you know, your own cartridges, as, you know, Rick Johnson apparently doesn't ship out of the country. It's not as easy if you're a sole proprietor, like most people are. Most people like that, just like Mike, they don't have a team, they don't have a staff, they don't have a loading dock, okay? They work out of their home. So here we were talking about the dream features of the new Pro 100, whatever that may be. I don't know what they're going to call it. I agree with the most of your dream list features, but the exception are the RGBing. So unless you're printing those exact three colors, then you're still needing to composite. Nope, I disagree. I disagree. We'll go back to the 9500. It used green and red, okay? And they would only come into play if you chose a certain type of paper that could take advantage of that. So yeah, there's going to be compositing. But at some point, what happens is, as you get from, let's see, how do you make green? Well, you cyan and yellow if you're using secondary colors. So if your image contains like a yellow green, sure, it'll composite it. It will composite it. It will be a little bit of cyan and mostly yellow, give you that greenish yellow look. At some point, you're going to reach a point where the print engine is going to say, oh, I'm much better off. I'm much better off using the proprietary green, just like the 9500 did. Okay. So don't give me that. 9500 had proprietary red, which is unheard of before, and green. Okay. Yes, most of the papers would actually use cyan and yellow to make green, and, you know, yellow and magenta to make reds. But some papers, basically, what they profited from the availability of a red and a green. Okay. Why do some printers have orange? Okay. Why do some printers still have green? Why do some printers have blue? Okay. This dude apparently coming across as a color engineer. No, sorry. Sorry, I disagree. Anyway, there's no way that would be a negative aspect. Okay. Absolutely not. I will deal with that guy later. We just won't do it tonight here. So yeah, that will not be a negative aspect. That would only be a positive aspect. And funny thing, print engines are amazing. They can do magic, okay? many times, if they are configured correctly, you may not even need a light version of cyan or a light version of magenta. You just want, if you have some grays, that kind of helps. So we'll use full strength magenta and just gray to water it down, if you will, and allow you to create a nice smooth transitional tonal changes. The, if I remember, the R2000 doesn't have light magenta. It just, I mean, light cyan, it just doesn't. It just has straight cyan. Doesn't need it, you see? So the print engine can do wonders. It can actually do with what you, in some cases, it seems to be like a not enough colors, but it doesn't seem to have a problem, all right? So again, if you're gonna have a 10 channel printed, like I was proposing, why not include it? Why not? Why not? Even if it's used only 5% of the time, so what? That was the case with the 9500. It was only used about 5% of the time. People would complain that, oh, my red and green don't seem to be used at all. You're not using the right paper. Okay. Once you kick in that type of paper that requires those two, then you will begin to use it. And you will see the difference between not using it and using it, compositing and not compositing. So don't give me that. All right. We're down to 36. I think it's time to say goodbye, folks. So let me go ahead and play a little bit of music here. We're going to turn it way down. I love that one that I found. So like I said, I'm going to go ahead and do a more extensive video on the analysis of that standard image. I didn't get a chance to do it this past week, but I will this week. And then there are a couple other little subjects I'm going to go ahead and cover. And should be able to have a couple more videos up this week. I'm up to almost 1,500 videos. It's getting out of hand. I really don't have that much more to talk about except the new stuff that's out. I'll go ahead and look at Epson's site and see if I can get some specs on the two new printers. The ones that are in the family where we home users can use, I don't want to look at anything that's a floor unit. That's way beyond us here and me as well. So, and we'll do a few more comparisons and that'll be it. So I hope you guys enjoyed this again. As always, always a pleasure for me to hang out with you guys. I don't know how you guys do it. How do you put up with me? I never know. All right. Thank you so very much. And until the next time, happy printing, everybody. Bye-bye.